I hope all of you understood condition to leave the surface is normal ratio becoming zero. So we'll write equation, the Newton laws of motion, second law of motion equation at C and put n equal to zero. That will give me velocity at point C. Velocity at point B is given. So I'll correlate point B and C with work energy theorem. Should I solve or should I wait?
So 1 minute, sir.
Sir, 2 minutes.
Okay. I'll just draw free body diagram at point C. Normal direction mg, and there is a centripetal acceleration. This is acceleration v square by r. At point C, equation, the laws of motion equation is mg cos theta minus n. This is net force. This should be equal to mass times acceleration. Did you get this equation?
Yes.
Okay.
So is it b cos inverse of theta?
Yes, sir.
I doubt that is correct, but let's see. I hope you have not used a ready-made expression. Anyways, so normal direction is zero.
Sir, option C.
Option C. Who said this?
Sir, Chomik.
Chomik. Yes, that I think if I remember correctly, answer is C. So normal direction is zero. So from here, you will get velocity at point C square should be equal to G into R into cos of theta. This is the first relation. This is the condition for it to leave the surface. Okay, this should happen. Otherwise, it can't leave the surface at C. Now, I am going to use work energy theorem. W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus u1 plus k1. Okay, so w is zero. Gravity is doing work, but for that I am using potential energy. Okay, and I am going to say that this horizontal line is zero gravitational potential energy. This represents ug, gravitational potential energy, to be zero. Okay, so k1 is half mv naught square, so m into v naught square. V naught is 0.5 root gr. U1 is zero, right? Now k2 is half m into v square, where v square is gr cos theta. What about u2? Anyone? U2 is what? To find u2, I need to find how much below it is, vertically how much below it is from the zero potential energy line. So this distance is how much? Tell me how much is this distance?
So r minus r cos theta.
This distance is r cos theta. Okay, and the complete distance from here to here is r. So that distance is r minus r cos theta. So potential energy will be negative, right? Because it is going below the this thing. It is going below the zero potential energy line. So it will be minus of mg r minus r cos theta. Fine. So just substitute the values. V naught is 0.5 root gr. V square is gr cos theta, and put everything, and I think you will get cos theta to be equal to 1 by 4. Can you confirm it once? Anyone? Can you solve this?
Yes, sir. I got one.
See, you get 2 by 3, you will get cos inverse 2 by 3. When it starts from rest, you just gently push it forward. Then I think you'll get cos inverse 2 by 3. But if initial velocity is there, then the angle will be different. All of you understood? Any doubts?
So what will be lesser if it's moving with some velocity?
Will it be lesser if it is going with some velocity? See, you're saying angle will be lesser.
Yes, I'm saying that if it's already going with some velocity, it should quickly fall off.
It should quickly fall off. Yes, your argument seems to be correct.
So it should be 3 by 4.
No, that argument could be correct, but what we have got is the fact, okay? Answer is 1 by 4 only. I am wondering about what should I say, okay? The answer is 1 by 4 only. You can't, qualitatively, you can't say and arrive at the answer. You have to find out what is the answer using equations.
No, sir, I solved these equations only.
Oh, you got 3 by 4.
Sir, even I got
3 by
4.
3 by 4
only. Oh, then answer is 3 by 4. Shomik, you said 1 by 4. Can you check?
Sir, I got 1 by 4.
Okay. Whatever it is, this is the equation to solve. These are the two equations. First equation, second equation. Okay. Fine, let us go to the next question. This one is very similar to what we have just done, okay? So do it properly and get the answer.
rigid C 3 sin beta equal to 2 cos alpha.
Others?
Yes, sir. Even I got 3 sin beta is equal to 2 cos alpha.
Yes, sir. Same.
Okay. Fine. So it leaves the cylinder at point B, right? So I'll draw the free body diagram of B. This is MG. This is normal reaction. And acceleration is V square by R towards the center. So one thing you may have to notice here is that this angle is 90 minus beta. It's not beta, because beta is given with horizontal. Okay, so you'll write mg cos of 90 minus beta, which is mg sine beta minus normal reaction, is equal to mass time acceleration v square by r. So normal reaction zero when it leaves the cylinder. So v square, that is velocity at b square, is equal to gr sine of beta. Okay, this equation I'm assuming all of you got it. Some of you might have done the silly error taking cos beta instead of sine beta, but have you got this relation? Any doubts here? Skanda bolega bhai. Doubts? Am I audible? Oh, Skanda typed. I just saw that.
Yes, sir.
All right. Fine. So between A and B, I will use work energy theorem. W is equal to U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay. W is zero. And let me assume this. I can assume any horizontal line to be zero potential energy. Okay. So just for the sake of convenience, I am assuming this horizontal line to be zero gravitational potential energy. Okay. So that is why U2 is zero, because I have assumed that to be zero. K1 is zero. It starts from rest. Okay. K2 is half m v square. V square is gr sine beta. So this is m into v square, so mgr sine beta. Fine. U1 is the initial potential energy. Initial potential energy is mg into h, and where is h? This is h. How much is this length? This length is r cos alpha. This is R cos alpha, and this one is R sine of beta. Yes or no? Is it understandable?
Yes, sir.
this is r cos alpha minus r sine beta. Okay. Ananya, have you understood what is written here? MGH is written here. H is r cos alpha minus r sin beta. Okay, there is no Ananya here. No, Ananya H is here. Ananya Ramchandra, three Ananyas we have. Oh, that is why these guys are keeping quiet, huh? So I should tell the full name. Ananya Ramchandra, have you understood? Ananya AR. Aniruddha, have you understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. So when you simplify this, you will get the answer. Okay. So what answer you will be getting? You'll get 3 sine beta. 3 sine beta is equal to 2 cos alpha. So you'll get C. When you simplify this, let's move to the next question. This one, you can solve one by one. 13th, first you answer 13th question. Anyone? First, you need to find out what is the minimum velocity required for it to reach the point D. For an object to just to reach point D, normal reaction at D should be zero. Right? It loses contact, just loses contact at D. So normal reaction becoming zero there is the condition for minimum velocity. Once you find that velocity, that into 2 by root 5 is the initial velocity. Anybody got the minimum velocity?
So the 24 gr by 5 the whole rule.
24 gr by 5.
You got whole root 5 gr.
Root 5 gr is the answer for the minimum velocity at A. Okay, so I'll quickly do this. Guys, do a lot of practice, okay? This chapter, I mean, you can't just attend the lecture and hope to do well in the numericals. That has never happened and it will never happen, okay? You have to back it up with a lot of problem practice at home. Otherwise, everything is going waste. So, at the topmost point, this is normal reaction. Then there is mg also. And acceleration is, let's say, v square by radius is, let's say, capital R, so v square by R. So at the topmost point, n plus mg, net force, is equal to mass times acceleration, mv square by R. So normal reaction is zero at the topmost point if it just leaves the surface. So for normal reaction zero, V square should be equal to G times R. Okay, this is the velocity at point D. Okay, now between A and D, I'm going to use work energy theorem. So W is U2 plus, I don't know, we have done this many times. Okay, so
Can we just use the motion in a vertical circle formula?
Under root 5GL? That is for the pendulum. Yes, that's for pendulum, right? This is not a pendulum. Although the final answer looks like a pendulum one only, because it turns out to be similar equation, but it's not a pendulum. That vertical circle motion we have done for the pendulum, where tension is there. Here, normal reaction is there. Anyways, so W is 0. K1 is half mu square, where u is a velocity at point A, u1 is 0, k2 is half mv square, so it will come out to be mgr by 2, and u2 is mg into this distance, that height, which is 2r, okay? So this is mgh, so mg into 2r. From here, you will get velocity to be equal to root over 5gr. This is the minimum velocity required for the object to reach point D. All of you understood this? Any doubt on this one? Minimum velocity to reach point D is root of 5gr. Okay? अरे कोई बोल ही नहीं रहा है हाँ अभिषेक अंडरस्टूड सुशांत विभव ओके सो दिस इज द मिनिमम वेलोसिटी रिक्वायर्ड फॉर इट टू रीच पॉइंट डी सो currently the velocity is 2 by root 5 times the minimum velocity. So velocity of projection right now is 2 by root 5 times of root 5 gr. So that is 2 root gr. This is the velocity. Okay. So at what angle the block gets separated from the track? Okay. Let's say that this is the track. It starts from here. Let's say it separates there at an angle of theta. Okay, so this is point A and C. So if it separates at point theta, then again you can write down the laws of equation relation. This is mg, this is normal reaction, and acceleration is v square by r. Okay, so if you write the laws of motion equation, if it had to be find max velocity, what we have to do? Aditya, maximum velocity is infinite. This is the minimum velocity. After this, whatever velocity you give, it will cross D. There is no limit up to max for the maximum velocity. Minimum velocity, there is a limit. So at point C, if you write the Newton's laws of motion equation, you will get mg cos, no, this is theta, so this will be 91 theta, so you'll have mg sine theta there, mg cos of 91 theta, so mg sine theta minus normal reaction is equal to m velocity square divided by r. So v square should be equal to g r sine theta, okay, where it loses the contact. Now I am going to use the work energy theorem between A and C now, okay? So W is 0, okay, W is 0, and U2 is what? U2 is this height is R plus R sine theta. Okay, so I'll write mg r plus r sine theta. So mg r 1 plus sine theta plus half mv square at point C. V square is this. So it will be mg r sine theta. This is u2 plus k2. Okay, u1 is 0 and k1 is half m into this velocity square. This one, okay, so this will be half into 4 into gr, okay. So once you solve this equation, what answer you will get? Can anyone tell me?
I got C.
Sure, C, sir.
C even m will come. So again, cancel out mgr from everywhere. So I'll get 1 plus 2 sine theta, 1 plus 2 sine theta minus is equal to 0, right? So sine theta is half. Wait, what silly error we have done? Can you identify what silly error we have done? Half mv square. Oh, there will be half here. This is v square. So half mv square is the kinetic energy. So this is 1 by 2. So sine theta plus sine theta by 2 is 3 by 2 sine theta. So sine theta will come out to be 2 by 3. So option C is correct. Okay. See, if you see that, the complication is with respect to solving the equations, because ultimately how you use the equation is the same. Doesn't matter which question you are solving, same thing we are doing again and again, just that equations are getting formed in a different manner. So that is what it is making it slightly tricky. So it's not the physics which is making it difficult, it is the calculation or mathematics which is making it tricky. So that problem will go away when you solve your own lot of questions. Okay, so other two questions, 14 and 15, I'll keep it as homework. All right, so let's go to the next one. So here is the question, guys, all of you. Suppose you have a pendulum of mass m. Okay, this is a pendulum of mass m and length is l. Okay, you have given it a velocity u which is equal to under root of 3gl. Okay, this is the velocity with which this is thrown, like that, initial velocity. You need to find out the angle the string will rotate. The string may go like that before it becomes slack. Okay, so you need to find out what angle it makes with the horizontal before it becomes slack. All of you understood the question, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes, sir.
Solve it. See, it is not root 5GL. Had it been root 5GL, it will swing to a full circle. But it is less than root 5GL, so it will not swing to the full circle.
So is it sine inverse of 1 by 3?
Others?
Sir, I got the sine inverse of half.
Okay.
I got sine inverse 1 by 3.
Yes, sir. I also made a mistake. It's 1 by 3.
So if it the string, if it becomes slack at the topmost point, tension will become zero, right? So this will mg, this is mg, this is tension, this is 90 minus theta. Okay, so I can say that T plus mg cos of 90 minus theta, which is mg sine theta. This is the force towards the center. This should be equal to, okay, this should be equal to the mass time acceleration. So this is mv square by L. Now if string is slack at that point, if a string is slack, tension is zero, okay? So that is why v square should be equal to g into L into sine theta.
Or sine inverse of 1 by 3.
Okay. Let's say this is point number 1 and this is point number 3. So now I am applying work energy theorem between these two points. W is equal to U1 plus K1, U2 plus K2 minus U1 plus K1. Okay. W is 0, K1 is half mu square, so u square is 3gl, is K1, U1, I am assuming this line to be 0 potential energy, this horizontal line, I am assuming 0 potential energy, so U1 because of our assumption is 0, K2 is half m into v square, so half m into GL sine theta. Okay. U2 is what? Anyone?
MG into L plus L sine theta.
MGL plus L sine theta. Because I have to see vertically how much above it is. So this distance is L sine theta because it is 90 degree plus L. Fine. So this is the equation. Now I can cancel out MGL. L and L gone. So I'll have 1 plus sine theta plus sine theta by 2 minus 3 by 2 is equal to 0. Okay, this is what I will get, right? Okay, yes, this is what I will get. So I will have 3 sine theta by 2 minus 1 by 2 is equal to 0. So from here I will get sine theta as 1 by c. So theta is sine inverse 1 by 3. I hope all of you have understood this. No doubts, right?
Yes, understood.
Okay. Now there are few questions which are which connects one chapter to the other chapter. Okay, so let's solve one such question which connects work per energy chapter with the projectile motion. Okay. There are so many such questions which connect multiple chapters together. Okay, so what happens is a bomb is thrown a harmless bomb. It is thrown at 37 degree from the horizontal with a speed of 100 meter per second. Okay, at the highest point, when it reaches the highest point of its trajectory, the bomb explodes at the highest point. And the ratio of there will be two parts that comes out. The ratio is 1:3. Mass of one part is 1/3 of the mass of the other part. Okay, the smaller part, the velocity of smaller part becomes zero immediately. Okay, and the smaller part, because of that, falls vertically down like this. Okay, you need to find out what happens to the larger part. Larger part will go forward, and let's say it reaches here. So you need to find out this distance. The range of the larger part is what? All of you understood the question?
Sir, when will it explode, sir? Like, or it won't matter?
It explodes at the highest point. That is what I said, right? At the highest point, it explodes. Okay? Hello? Solve it now. This is also one of its kinds numerical. You may not get it right, but at least try it.
Sir, we need to find the distance covered by the third part, the second part.
Second part, yes. From the initial point of projection, what is the distance?
Sir, we know that the second part is projected horizontally after it blasts, or we don't know that.
That is not given.
Okay, sir.
Can I conserve momentum when explosion happens? Yes or no? Can I conserve momentum?
Yes, sir.
I can conserve momentum. This is a collision only. It is a collision. I can conserve momentum. So at the highest point, the momentum is only along the horizontal direction. Yes or no? Horizontal direction is the momentum before the explosion. After explosion, the momentum of the smaller part becomes zero. Okay? So that, again, that is like a hint I have given you. Now try it.
So what's sine 37? Oh, it's given.
You should remember, by the way, it will not be given in the exam. Remember, 37 degree is a 3, 4, 5 triangle. Pythagorean triplet triangle.
Okay, sir. Should I do it?
Sir, is it 1204.8 meter?
1204.8. Okay. Others? You've taken G as 9.8?
Oh, sir, I took it as 10.
Okay. What about others?
Sir, I got
61.
Sir, 1600.
1600. Okay, let me solve it now. Let's say mass of the bomb is M. Okay, so clearly one of the when it explodes, one of the particle will have M by 4 mass and other one will have 3M by 4, right? Some of the masses should be M only and the ratio should be 1:3. So M by 4 and 3M by 4 will be the masses. So initial momentum just before the explosion, it had only horizontal component of the velocity. So initial momentum is M into 100 cos 37. Any doubt here? At the topmost point, this is the momentum. Any doubt? No doubt. And the momentum of M by 4 is 0. So M by 4 into 0 plus 3M by 4 into velocity along x direction for the 3M by 4. Okay? Because I am conserving momentum along x direction right now. So I'll take velocity along x axis. Fine. So this is anyway 0. M and M goes away. So you will get Vx, velocity along x axis for 3m by 4 is 400 by 3 into cos of 37, which is 4 by 5. Okay. So this is 80. 320 by 3 meter per second. This, you've got this one. Anybody?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is the velocity along x-axis. What will be the velocity along y-axis for the 3m by 4 mass?
Zero,
because initial momentum along y-axis is zero. So along y-axis, initial momentum is zero, and momentum of m by 4 mass is also zero. So when you write it as 3 by 4 m into velocity along y direction, even vy will come out to be zero. Okay, so there is no velocity after explosion in the y direction for the 3 m by 4 mass. So it is like a horizontal projectile projected like this. And this height is what? Height you can find out from the maximum height formula. So maximum height is given as u square sine. What is the formula for maximum height? U square sine square theta by 2g. So this will give me height. Okay. Now it is like a horizontal projectile now. It is projected with velocity of 320 by 3 meter per second with a height of h. So this distance, we have done this type of numerical so many times, right? So time of flight is under root 2h by g. So this distance, let us say this is r1, okay? So r1 will be velocity into time. Velocity along x-axis is unchanged. So this velocity into root over 2h by g. This is r1. r1 is what? This distance. And that distance is how much? That distance is the half of the range of the initial projectile. So that distance... The range is u square sine 2 theta by g. So let's say this is r2. r2 will be u square sine 2 theta by 2g, half of it. So answer is r2 plus r1. Go through it once and let me know if you have any doubts quickly.
Sir, can you just repeat the ranges part?
The range formula is u square sine 2 theta by g. Now, had it not exploded, it would have come and hit here. This would have been total range. So, from here to here, it did not explode. So, this distance would be half of the range. Total range is u square sine 2 theta by g. So, r2 is half of that. So, by 2g. And r1 we have got from here. So total range is r1 plus r2.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is one of the kinds, and you learn a few concepts when you study this type, new type of numericals you have to get exposed to. So whenever you solve problems, you know, don't just solve same kind of numericals again and again. So suppose you just take a numerical in which a horizontal force is applied and you have to find the acceleration. Now, you can't solve numericals where horizontal force has different values. All that are same kind of numericals. So, when you practice, make sure you practice different varieties of the numerical. For example, this one is another question that we are going to solve now. Please draw this diagram.
Sir, what was the answer for the previous one?
Previous one, the answer was equal to... it was 1120, I think. I don't know where it went.
Yes, sir, I got that.
You got it? 1120 is the answer. 1120. Okay. Fine. So here is the next question. Okay. All of you, please draw this. this is the last question for today. So I hope all of you get it correct. Try to do it systematically. You will get it correct. It can be done easily. Okay. Do it systematically. This is M, and spring constant K. A light spring of spring constant K is kept compressed between the two blocks small m and capital M. Okay, this one is capital M. The second one is capital M. It is kept on a smooth horizontal surface. This surface is smooth. Okay. When released, the blocks acquire velocities in opposite direction. It was initially compressed. After that, of course, they will acquire velocities in the opposite direction. They will move away from each other. Spring will push both of them. Okay. The spring loses contact with the blocks when it acquires natural length. As soon as the spring comes to the natural length, spring detaches itself from the masses. Fine. So spring gets detached. When it comes to natural length. Okay. So if initial compression of the spring is X, okay, you need to find final speeds of small m and capital M. Okay, so velocity of small m is v1 and let's say v2. You need to find what is the value of v1 and what is the value of v2. Have you understood the question? Any doubt on the question? Quickly ask. The hint is again same momentum and work energy theorem, nothing else, simple.
So the velocity of small m will be x by 2 root k by m.
Have you assumed both the masses equal?
No, sir.
That is wrong answer. One is a small m, other is capital M. Don't you think velocity of small m depends on how big or small the capital M is? If capital M is huge, small m will have all the kinetic energy. If capital M is very less, small m will have lesser velocity.
Okay, sir.
A spring is pushing both the blocks with the same force, both sides. So smaller block will accelerate more, bigger block will accelerate less. Spring has fixed amount of energy to give. So like that you can think, and if you're getting answer independent of one of the masses, that is wrong. Should I do it? Somebody said something. Who said? Should I solve? Okay, I will solve now. First is conservation of momentum. Tell me what is the initial momentum?
Zero.
Initial momentum. Areman, what it is? Areman? Vibhav Vasudevan, what is initial momentum? Tell me. All bodies are at rest, so initial momentum is zero. This should be equal to the final momentum. After spring comes with natural length, let's say velocity is v1 and v2. So this will be equal to m into v1. Minus capital M into V2. Okay. This is the first equation, which is conservation of momentum. Okay. Now, I am going to use work energy theorem. Now, I don't know whether you have seen it, but I am like bored of doing same thing again and again, because every problem, even though situation is different, but when you solve it, you will see that all of them look same. Okay, if you're not able to visualize it to be same, then probably you may have to do some practice. After some practice, you'll see that you'll feel every question is same. K1 is zero, both the masses at rest. U1 is half kx square, initial compression is there, right? U2 is 0 and K2, both the masses have kinetic energy now. K2 will be equal to half small m into V1 square plus half capital M into V2 square, and W is 0 because spring is the only force that is doing work, and for that you have considered the potential energy. Right, this is my second equation. Fine. So when you solve these two equations, you'll get V1 to be equal to root over K times capital M divided by small m capital M plus small m times x. Okay, this is v1, and v2 you will get it as kmx divided by capital M into small m plus capital M. See, all you have to do is substitute the value of v2 in terms of v1 from here. V2 is equal to small m by capital M times v1. So when you put it here, you'll get the value of v2. Once you get v2, again use this equation to get v1. All of you understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so today we have exhaustively covered the chapter work by energy, and again I'm telling you, if you don't do practice, you'll remember my words. These two chapters, work energy, work by energy. Acha, by the way, power is something which we haven't covered. It's a very, very small topic. Just 2 minutes will take. So what I was saying was that work by energy and laws of motion, these are extremely important topics. So please do practice for your own sake. Practice at least 100 questions of work by energy. Then you don't have to worry about the chapter anymore. Okay. I'll quickly cover the power part of the chapter. Okay. It's extremely small. It takes 5 minutes. Please write down power. Power is nothing but rate at which work is done. Rate of work done. See, it is like, two people doing the same amount of work, but one person doing faster. So the time factor comes into the play. So time is a very, very important factor. For example, if you are hungry and food is getting cooked, you don't want food to be cooked in 2 days of time. The amount of energy used will be same. But if your cook get if your food get cooked in, let's say, half an hour, the rate at which energy is supplied to the food is much faster, right? So time is a very, very important factor. Another example could be a very strong person doing a work and a very weak person is also doing the same amount of physical work I am talking about. So the weaker one will take a lot of time, but amount of work done will be same. Okay, so that is why we need to also take into account the time factor when we calculate the work done. And power is one of the physical quantity which takes into account the factor of time. So it's, since the definition is rate of work done, so power is simply derivative of work done, dW by dt. Okay. Now, work done can be written as f dot dr. So entire dW can be written as f dot dr divided by dt. dW is f dot dr divided by dt. Okay. Now this can be rearranged as f dot dr by dt. Now what is dr by dt? It's velocity, right? So dot product of force with the velocity is the work done. Fine. And the SI unit of power is watts. Okay, so there are direct question on power. There will not be any complicated question. There will be a force given and the velocity of object is given. So all you have to do is take a dot product of force and velocity, you'll get the power. Or at times W is given as a function of time. For example, W is given as 2t square. So power is derivative of W. So it will be 4 into t. Okay. So questions like these you will see for the power. There will not be any very, very difficult questions on power. Okay. So that's it, guys. This chapter is over. And next topic will start from the book 2. Okay. Fine. So we'll meet next week, most probably. Bye bye for now.
Thank you, sir.